coming to you from MITV. You just missed our headline track segment review. And now we are going on straight to our discussion segment where we'll be talking about the economy, specifically the SMEs sector, and how we can actually use that to revamp the issue of unemployment, specifically amongst the youth. We're being joined by Dr. Femi Egbesola. He's the president of the Association of Small Business Owners of Nigeria. Dr. Femi, you're welcome on the show.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Good to have you, sir.
Yeah. It's good to be with
you. I know that
morning.
You're just the right person to have on the program this
I
morning
guess so.
Because of the wealth of experience you already have in this direction. You're welcome, sir.
Thank you once again.
All right, sir. So we're talking about how SMEs can create better jobs for Nigerian youth. Let's first of all find out how that sector is actually faring presently.
Well, we have to give it to the last administration. They focused more on SMEs than ever before, and that helped to boost the output of SMEs in all ramifications. We can see that now SMEs contributing more to the GDP than ever before. Formerly, it was said that SMEs contribute less than 1% to the GDP, but now as much as 20% to the GDP. I think that's good. Also, too, more jobs have been created by SMEs than ever before, especially since the period of SAP, short adjustment program, when everybody decided to look inward and see what they can do to help themselves. So now SMEs are creating more jobs. In fact, the National Bureau of Statistics says now that SMEs are creating about 70% of the jobs we have in the country, and that means that they are really the engine of economic growth, as everybody has agreed that they were. And it also shows that if we really pay more attention to SMEs, we will be able to create more jobs, we will be able to improve our economy, and everybody will be better for each at the end of the day.
That's a very good idea. You just said that about 70, I think the National Bureau of Statistics, about 70% of jobs being created can come from the SMEs sector. But then it's still worrisome to find that with all this good statistics, and all that, we still have issues of unemployment, specifically amongst the youth.
Yes, Nigeria is one of the countries ranked highest as the most unemployed state in the world. It means that so much is still left to be done by the SMEs themselves, by the government, and by every other stakeholder. And this is because the enabling environment is not really there. If you look at the Asian tigers in this world, the kind of encouragement and support that their government gave to them were able to get them to where they are today. And that's why you can see about 50 million SMEs creating about 500 billion jobs in Asia alone. And we can also have that here if governments decide to prioritize and place utmost urgency on this sector. The sector, like I did say, is known as the engine of growth, the vehicle of economic development in any country. But unfortunately, this sector has been neglected for so many decades. I said the other time that we are just seeing some ray of hope in this last administration, and we believe that we are in the time of change. Many more changes will come up to this sector again, and bring in good policies that can really revamp the sector. Unfortunately, one of the major challenges this sector has been facing is funding. It's funding, yes. It has been very difficult to access funding. You must have heard of the 200 billion CBN fund for MSMEs. The question is, how many people have been able to access it? How many people have actually been able to access it? This fund is sitting down there. Very few hands are getting it. Even this year again, very close to the end of this administration, another 40 billion naira was launched.
Yes,
March this year, 40 billion naira was launched. The question is, how many people are able to access it? The banks too are not really helping matters.
But then, we have, you said issues of funding, and the government actually brings out loads of promises and all that. Specifically, the last one was in March, before they went down in May. You know, so when we have all this money, so how come we now have issues of actually getting this money?
That's where the problem is. It's because we always, often than not, have the square peg in the round hole. The government, in their wisdom, sit down there to formulate very wonderful policies, very good ideas. But the implementation and the monitoring has actually been the problem. Yes, and that's why it's been difficult for the SME, the real SMEs, to actually access this fund. because the stakeholders are not actually brought on board. We have the BMO, the Business Membership Organization, that can really assist government in formulating and implementing their policies. But when these BMOs are not taken along, we will continue to have this bureaucratic bottleneck that we're experiencing at the moment, whereby the money will be there. They will set up conditions that most often than not, these SMEs cannot meet up with. Many SMEs do not have collateral, they do not have landed properties. You can imagine the cost of even getting a CFO in Lagos State today. So if you want to give an SME a loan of maybe 2-3 million, and it takes him about 1 or 2 million to process a CFO to use for that loan, of course, how will he actually get the money at the end of the day? So some of these policies are not good enough for SMEs, and they are not very friendly enough for SMEs. I think the best way out of it is to always engage stakeholders. That's why we have associations like this. We have so many associations in this country for business people, and the best way to do it is to bring them on board, and also, if possible, channel some of these funds through the financial institutions, through these SMEs, and that's the only way the SMEs can access. I can say categorically that we have less than 30% SMEs that have access to this fund, that fund, this intervention fund,
and the rest,
which is very, very, very low. Even 200 billion naira is not enough for the SME sector in Nigeria. Talk less of accessing just 30% of 200 billion naira. So it's a really cause for concern for the SMEs, and then we feel that things will change with this new government. We feel they will have more listening here, not just listening here. We feel they will also be able to implement better than what we had the other time. Well, let's give it to them that they have started it. Let's see how it will go this time, and we hope SMEs will benefit more.
Yes, everyone knows that the creation of SMEs is one of the, let me say, most laudable initiatives that the federal government has, encouraged in the last few years. But I know that they also have some bodies like maybe the BOI, BOA, and some of those organizations that are supposed to support the growth of SMEs in the country. Now, do these bodies actually have policies on ground to facilitate the proliferation of these SMEs? Do they have some or any?
Yes. Over time, they have been developing various kind of policies, and they have been improving on it from time to time. But the real fact is that we have a very peculiar case in Nigeria. So if you are looking at the template of America of this world, the United Kingdom of this world, and you want to use it to work with SMEs here in Nigeria, you will always get it wrong. Mm-hmm. And that's where the gap is here. That's where the gap is. Now, I'll not be able to come down home and study our environment.
Our own peculiar
challenges. Our environment. Mm-hmm. Even if you go through this definition of what they call SMEs, it's not applicable here. When you say SMEs, someone that employs between 10 and 100 staff or employees, and then you have about 50 million naira. How many people ask that to be business in Nigeria? So they have not been able to actually come down for the peculiar need here related to the SMEs, and they address our policies to that particular need, and that's where the gap is. Today, BOI has actually funded some organizations, some SMEs, but the percentage is down too low. If we have, according to statistics, we have about over 70 million SMEs, and today we can say less than 1 million has benefited, it means that the gap is still very wide. And that means that more needs to be done to actually address that sector. It's good that the media, too, is also hyping it this time. The media here and there are talking about SMEs, and it means that change is about to come. It means that things will improve. And I want to give the opportunity to thank you this morning for talking about this topic, this SME, and also bringing me in to also shed more light on what I know about this this issue. So the SME sector is a critical sector that we all must look into. Everybody stand must be on deck. And it's good that government is realizing this time around. Even the banks now realize that they just must focus on SME if they have to grow. The free funds are no longer there for them to play with. And I keep saying, if we have 50 million SMEs in this country, and then this 50 million can employ just three people, we will be looking for people to employ, because that means that we need 150 million. So in a country of about 180 million, and 150 million people are needed to be employed, and we already have 50 million, but that makes it 200 million. That means we're looking for people to employ. So it's good to focus on this and then divest from this oil industry and look inwards to better a lot. If we really want to grow our GDP, if we really want to make our country a better place, then the answer to it, the key to it, is SME.
Okay, SMEs now, fine. You just talked about trying to grow SMEs to about 50 million. From statistics, we have over 17 million SMEs spread across the country, okay, which is laudable as a trend, but then we can still do better. So, fine. Today we're focusing on the unemployment, on the youth and all that. As a school leader who just left school, I know that and couldn't get a job over years, 4 or 5 years, and we're now talking about SMEs. How possible does a school leader go? How far can he go to embrace SMEs and start doing something that actually better his lot and actually get to employ more people?
And the first hand, every business person started from nothing. Even Dangote of this world was not born with billions. He grew like everybody and then embraced entrepreneurship, and that took him to where he is today. So I think the first thing is to believe that you can do it. If you believe you can do it, then the next thing is to begin to look for ideas you want to work with. Because when the idea is there, you now begin to look for funding, how to fund it. We have so many entrepreneurs that have started with their own funds that they have been able to save. Maybe when they were in school, it's more stupid, they collect, they gather it together. We have some graduates who started entrepreneurship even when they were in school, doing photography and some other little jobs to save some funds. We have graduates who have been able to approach their family, their friends to get some money, and they started business with this. Unfortunately, in this country, much emphasis is not placed on assisting graduates to start business, because in the advanced world, we have certain funds known as startup fund for graduates, such that the funds are at very, very low interest rates. Some of them as low as 0.1% interest rate. It's more or less like free. But in Nigeria here, everybody running away from startup. The banks don't want to give money to startup. The government don't want to give money to startup. The only program I know of that is meant for startup is this UWIN program. We have had about 3 editions of the UWIN program. Each edition takes about 1,000 people. So if you have 3,000 people in the figure of the unemployed, it's still a lot less. Yes, it's still a lot less. So we really need to also encourage graduates by giving them some startup funds. If the banks are not ready to partner with startups because they see them as high risk, the government is not ready to partner with startups, who will partner with startups? Is it high that we use bigger money that I'm running business with for startups? And that's where the challenge is.
But don't you think that the reason why the banks and all the lending and organizations may not want to give funds to young graduates to start up could be that of an experience and training, and they don't have the requisites and training?
Yeah, we have something on one of the papers this morning, Business World. It says, death of SME experts in banks slows Nigeria's economy.
Yes. You say they don't manage funds well, it's because they lack the requisite training, they lack the capacity building. So government also has that responsibility to build capacity. The banks have that responsibility to do so. Some association like us has that responsibility to do so. If somebody is not doing well, you don't condemn him. You give him more training so that he can do well. What is really the problem with Africa is managerial skill and ability to have good record keeping and accountability. That's what the problem of most of our SMEs are. But this can be tackled through capacity building. So if we're able to train them, they will definitely do better. And I don't want to believe that because this is high risk, because they don't manage money, we cannot give them money. I don't believe that. Just this year, a bank declared them 99 billion naira profits. Yes, 99 billion naira profits. If such banks decide to set aside just 10% of their profits for SMEs and startups, I think it's good. It's good for us. It means that we'll be able to sow into the life of these graduates and the unemployed. And at the end of the day, it will bring more results, because if we have, like I did say, we have 50 million Nigerians in the SME sector, and these 50 million Nigerians can really back every month to deposit as much as 2 million Naira. Mm-hmm. Multiply it together, it's a lot of money, and the bank will also be better for it. But if we continue to neglect them, we continue to say that they are high risk, they are this, they are that, they cannot manage, we will continue to be in the same position. And we don't need to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I was privileged to visit Malaysia, and I saw what is happening there to SMEs. They have a food fund, the government has a food fund, they even instruct all banks to bring in certain percentage of their profits to that food fund, and it is given to SMEs, especially startups. How do they do it? Before giving them that fund, they give them the prerequisite training for 3 months to know how to do this, how to do that, how to handle their books, how to manage their business, how to market their product or service, and the rest of it. Thereafter, they give them that money in tranches. If I'm going to give you 2 million naira, I can give you 500,000 naira to start with. Thereafter, I give you another 500,000 naira to go ahead before you master the game. In Nigeria here, if you want to start business, you have to provide everything for yourself. You can imagine a startup who wants to just package garri, and you tell him to go and get a NASDAQ number. And it will cost him about 200,000 naira to get a NASDAQ number. Where will he get that from? Aside from that fee, the structure to put in place for getting the approval of NASDAQ, where will he start from? So that organization will come, tax people will come, customs will come, everybody will come. Really, with that business not full of. But if you can give them such holidays, if you want to start, okay, we are not that, let's segment our approval. For you to start, we give you a professional approval for 6 months, let's see how it goes, or 1 year, let's see how it goes, let's see how you're able to do it. After that 1 year, it is mandatory for you to now come up, meet some other level of standards, and we give you another set of approval before you get to the final approval. We'll be able to encourage our people to actually go into business. I have so many people who package liquid soap, who package their other things, but the fear of NASDAQ makes them close the store. And even just 2 days ago, one of our members called me that police arrested him because he's not having NASDAQ number. This man produces payments. Pain doesn't have NASDAQ. But then police will capitalize on it.
And he's also ignorant.
Yes, it's ignorance. It's ignorance. And that's what we have here today, because the law are not really right. Everybody capitalizes on it. The corruption level is so high, everybody capitalizes on it and try to make money at the detriment of SMEs. At the detriment of SMEs. So government needs to pay particular attention to this time. And the best way to pay particular attention to it is bringing in the stakeholders on board. We are there, we know where the key thing is, we know what our people need, we know how such things can be done in a way that they will maximize the use of it and return the fund for whatever they want to give to them. Poverty is another issue. Power is another issue. Even if the funds are there and the power is not right, the cost of production will still be so high, and they may not be able to pay such funds. We also need to encourage the banks to reduce their interest rates. The interest rates on loans now is too high. You can imagine collecting a 10 million naira loan at about 25-30%. Yes, that's very, very high. How can a small business manage its business to be able to pay off that interest? And we particularly in our association, feel that it's time government does something real in this sector, because many of us are closing shop. Many of us are closing shop on a daily basis, and it's not good for business, it's not good for the country, it's not good for the economy, and it's not good for our youth too, because it is when SMEs are thriving that they can employ more staff, they can engage our youth that are roaming the streets. So when we talk of crime, when we talk of violence, and we are not talking about improving a lot of SMEs, we would not be able to stop this crime. You can imagine how much is being voted to fight the Boko Haram today.
Yeah.
If this money is put into proper use for many years past, maybe we will not have Boko Haram today. If these people are really educated, they engage meaningfully, maybe we will not have this Boko Haram today. Even in the Southwest here, if this situation continues like this, people must survive. Young minds are active, they want to engage themselves. So they don't find the right way to engage themselves in, definitely they will engage themselves wrongly. And it will affect all of us. Even the rich people in this part of the world will be affected. And that's why we really need to pay critical attention to this sector and then revive it, revamp it, and make it more vibrant or more versatile, such that it will be a veritable industry and sector that all of us will be proud of.
Yes, you know that the new administration has one of its mission to be to curb unemployment, to bring it to the barest minimum by creating employment for youths and all that. But we really don't have a picture of how they're going to accomplish that, whether by creating more jobs or encouraging SMEs and vocational skills. Now, do you think that if the new administration actually wants to fight unemployment, they need to go in this direction of encouraging SMEs?
Yes, that's the best way to fight unemployment. How many people can government employ? How many people can the large industries employ? They cannot employ much. Can that quickly employ 20 million people? It's not possible. We have to face the facts. But if I and you begin to employ 3 persons, 5 persons, 10 persons there, by the time you multiply it together, you get billions of people employed. So if you really want to fight unemployment, then the sector to go is to create an enabling environment for SMEs to thrive. That's the way out. That's the only way out. And that's what the advanced countries have worked on today. The economy of the US of this world is being sustained by SMEs. Mm-hmm. And they have particular agencies that cater for their needs. If you look at here, we don't have a particular agency. We have the Ministry of Trade, Commerce and Investment that cater for varied issues, but not one particularly directed to small business. In America, we have Small Business Administration directed to the needs of the SMEs. They don't have any other business they do than treating the issues, needs, and aspiration of SMEs. So we need to have first agency here that will be focusing on that, because that's the only way out. That's the only way out. Especially now that the dollar is getting higher and higher, by the way, and the price of the oil is also falling. We need to pay attention to this. Pay attention to SME, pay attention to agriculture, and you see our country becoming a better place.
Okay, do you really think we should actually talk more or emphasize more on entrepreneurship development as one of the courses that we should be doing in school? So just before graduates leave school, they should have that mindset of being business owners.
Yes, that is it. And the policy in place now is even bringing it down to the secondary school level, right? It's being incorporated in the syllabus, the curriculum of the secondary school students. That's good enough. I was privileged to lecture in some universities teaching entrepreneurial development studies. But what I found out was that many of those people who are even teaching in the university don't really know much about practical entrepreneurship. They fall out what you read in the book, which most often than not are not relevant in today's world. You understand, in today's world. So when you don't give out the best, you will not expect to get the best. That's the problem we have in the university these days. And that's why I keep encouraging the university to not limit the teaching of entrepreneurship to your lecturers alone. Engage people who are professionals outside your campus. Let them come in and also be part of this training exercise, so that the kind of students, the graduates you will have at the end of the day, will be those that know the nitty-gritty of entrepreneurship, not just the book knowledge. There's a wide difference between book knowledge and the practical one. That's why you will see people who will even sit on the SME desk in the back. They will tell you this business is good, this is not good, this will not fly. But let them retire and come out and come and do business. Then they will discover that there's a whole lot different between theory and practical. Yes. So the universities need to engage professionals to really teach these students real entrepreneurship, practical entrepreneurship. We have people who produce soap today. They learn how to produce soap from somebody, maybe on the street or somewhere. But at the end of the day, that soap may be very good, but it is not commercially viable. What do I mean by that? If you produce a soap and the cost of your production is like 50 naira, and you see that kind of soap in the market for 30 naira, how will you sell yours? It means that the technology you are using is archaic or not correct. So for you to be able to live in today's world, you must learn today's technology. But most often than not, the technology taught in the schools are technology of yesteryears which are not applicable to today's world, because life has really changed and it will continue to change daily.
Thank you so much, sir, for obliging our invitation this morning. Our guest has been Dr. Femi Egbeshola, who's the president of
this is the President Association of Small Business Owners of Nigeria, ASBON, and he's done justice to the issue of unemployment through SME funding and all of that.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you once more for your privilege.
All right, that's all we'll be taking on this segment of the program. We'll take a short break and when we return, we'll be linking up with Mr. Genga, who'll be telling us that some people you should avoid in your life. And then we'll, before then, we'll take a package still on this issue of creating jobs through SMEs. Stay with us.
In a country like Nigeria, where unemployment rates are extremely high, providing support for SMEs will have a positive effect on employment. This is true because many youth, graduates inclusive, have found a form of employment in small businesses or jobs, the kind expected to be covered by the Nigerian Business Development Services. SMEs create more jobs than large enterprises and even have a much higher employment growth rate than large enterprises. But the challenges facing SMEs in Nigeria are access to finance, poor infrastructure, inconsistency in government policies, poor business support development services, access to market, multiple taxation, and obsolete technology. To provide the environment for SMEs to create decent jobs for youths, it's imperative to have a universal policy to guide countries. SMEs can create better jobs by their countries collecting up-to-date periodically on SMEs so as to improve better or know what to work on. Improving access to finance through measures such as loan guarantees, starting grants, facilitation of crowdfunding, seeker-specific financial institutions, improved financial literacy for SMEs. Cooperatives and mutual associations can be an effective way of achieving scale and better position in supplier and end markets, as well as mobilizing savings and enhancing social security coverage. Special attention should be given to creating an enabling environment for cooperatives, in particular in rural areas. Attention should also be given to the modernization of technical and vocational education systems, lifelong learning, and to quality apprenticeship schemes in cooperation with several partners. Occupational safety and health frameworks should be adapted to establish a preventative safety and health culture and to address the disproportionate incidence of occupational accidents and health problems in SMEs. Although in Nigeria, SMEs do not currently account for job creation and inclusive growth, therefore, policymakers need to commit themselves to the creation of a business environment that is conducive to facilitating SME growth and development for youths. They should also create interventions that will support the startup, growth, and scaling of SMEs. They should create more jobs through agriculture and engage the youths in the various sectors of it. The SMEs can also create more jobs through trade. Young people represent more than 60% of Africa's population. Entrepreneurship skills and training, if supported through the right policies, can provide an effective solution to persistent youth employment in Nigeria.
out of segment, and we have joining us with Bagbenga Demujimi, who's a life coach. You're welcome, sir.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning, Joss.
Glad to have you join us again.
Yes, glad to have you this morning with your brown brown. I need to see this jacket.
Oh, no, we need to confiscate yours.
Yes, it's got one.
Oh, how are you? How's the weekend?
The weekend was okay.
Oh, good morning, great Nigerians. And we've been able to talk about the people you should avoid or the people you should be careful of.
Let's just use the word avoid.
Avoid. And the people you should celebrate, people you should have rapport with, and we should just run through them. And because next week we are starting another fresh topic that will enhance our productivity and delivery at our different places of work. Number one, we talk about anybody who feels any authority with your rebellion. That is, you have a goal, you have passion, you have vision, and all that. You should be careful of anybody who exposes that of yours. Then anyone who dishonors your focus, anyone who dishonors what God has given to you, anyone who is disloyal, anyone who is not loyal to you, anyone who is jealous of your position, popularity, or prosperity. Remember, I give example of somebody who is having about 10 cars and you are having only just one car, and he's still envious of you, he's still jealous of you. Such person needs to be avoided.
So before we leave that point, if that point is very, very common now, but my question is,
especially among you, women,
now how do you know if someone is jealous of you?
Wow.
How do you know?
Okay.
To be able to avoid that person.
People don't.
So some people they have a way of hiding it, just putting the guys over it.
Okay.
How do you know?
There's no way to not be exposed one day.
For example,
you are struggling to buy synthetic hair weaver.
And the person is buying the original.
And he's using the original
Ethiopian person.
Paraga or Paraga weaver.
And the person is still jealous.
He's still having yours. It's a serious problem.
Wow.
It is a serious problem. Many people don't know this.
I still understand why they would want to do that. They have
their DNA. It's in their DNA. There is nothing you can do to it. It's only him, himself or herself, can actually deal with it and actually sit down and talk to herself or pray to God or something, or maybe go to your church for deliverance or something. I hear you as an assistant pastor, so you can help people. I'm just kidding. Now, what I'm trying to say is, there is no way you not know, because you get to a point where, okay, let me give an example. It's as little as you go eat, and you have just panla fish, and in front of him or her, he's having snail, he's having croaker, he's having kidney, everything. And he says, let me taste out of your fish. Is called covetousness. Godliness with contentment is a great gain. And that is why we see most of us running into problems, most of our guys running into problems. You want to impress or you want to oppress, you now travel to Malaysia to go and sell your kidney because you want to drive one stupid car. It's foolishness and stupidity. That's where we found ourselves. If you don't know exactly what's happening in our society, young men traveling to go and sell their kidney because they want to drive a car. And our ladies, our young ladies in schools are dying for them. Oh, see that guy, look at his car. Do you know where he got the car from? Or somebody is even bringing the car to school or to office, and the father or the mother is the owner of the car. You are saying because of, nice car. Why don't you go and date the father? Because the father is the owner of the car, instead of dating him. That's what I'm saying. Anyway, that's by the way. So you will know anyone who is. See, if you are in a position, you are in an office, you are in a seat, anybody who is stealing the authority with lies about you and is laughing with you, you have to be careful about the person. That's part of being jealous. Yes. That's part of strife and envy. And you see, anywhere you see strife, anywhere, any organization you see strife, all manner of evil will be present. All manner, including assassination and murder. All right. Anyone who justifies the conduct of your enemies, somebody, let me give you an example. When I newly married, somebody in my family sent me a message that the next time I talk to her husband, that my marriage will be destabilized. And I now called my friend, who is close
to that person. Hey, look at what this person said. Even if I've offended her, why can't you get? He was justifying the statement that that person said. So it was after then I now knew that, oh, my friendship with you over the years is even harmful to me. And I started seeing, and I started recalling so many events that have happened. No matter what, I mean, I before you even, ah, why would I still say that? By talking to your husband and all that. So later I now realize that, oh, it's more than that. So you see, marriage is break my company, my organization, my work. It starts from somewhere which you are not careful about, especially with the people around you. Your Yoruba adage, they say, "Bikule oba pani tita o le pani." That is, if the death inside your family cannot kill you, the one outside cannot kill you. It is impossible for any armed robber to come and hit you if there is no internal information. There is somebody feeding them with something about you. That is why the good book says, recommends that he who keeps his mouth keeps his life. When you talk too much about your life, you expose yourself to the enemy. Anyway, anyone who feeds your doubt, and anyone who destroys your expectation.
That's important.
Who destroys your expectation?
Yeah. Maybe you are expecting a promotion at the workplace, and Jimmy is your friend. I have said that Jimmy, you know, I'm due for promotion. I said, which promotion? You? Which promotion? I better go sit down, Jerry. You don't want promotion now. Your time. The people that will get promotion, we already know them. You cannot fit in into it. Instead of, you see, words are powerful. Words are powerful. They are seeds. Once they are said, they are planted, and they will begin to germinate. Instead of her to say, oh, wow, really, it is true, I remember. The last time you got promotion was about 4 years ago. I believe it will come to pass. I believe God will do it. I believe with your diligence, with your performance and everything, with your appraisal at work, it will happen. Do you understand? Just encourage you. But anybody who is it, promotion come, promotion. Anyway, that's about that. But we need to take cognizance of the seven most important people in our life as well. Last week we said, number one, anyone who intercedes for you. And I said intercession is not necessarily prayer. Yeah. Anyone who solicits, anyone who advocates for you, make sure you take that person serious. Number two, anyone willing to battle for you in your absence. Not just to advocate now, but the person is ready to battle for you, to fight for your behalf. Oh, I saw Bayo. People were shouting at him that he stole a perfume in one of the shops. The person is ready, and they are talking about
to
defend you. Even though when you not get inside, he can slap you. Bayo, how dare you? Both. Why would you do that kind of thing? Yeah, he can do it, but publicly, he defends you. He battles for you. And he makes sure, he tries all his possible best. He takes steps to make sure that you are out of that problem. Not just to be saying it and be gossiping and be backstabbing, talking about you everywhere. No, but the person actually takes steps to help you. Meanwhile, I need to balance this. Anybody who run around with you during your problem and move away from you when you get solution is actually your enemy.
After getting solutions,
you
have issues.
When you have issues, so if you want to take you to prayer, take you to our party, take you to everywhere. But immediately you get solution, the person moves away from you and starts talking about you.
I've seen a scenario like that.
That person is actually the major enemy of your life.
So why run around with you in the first place?
Because they
are enjoying the problem.
They are enjoying the problem with you. They don't want you to suspect that they are the ones creating it. So you have to be careful. It will be so obvious. They will just fight. They will just come. They will just fight you unnecessarily. Then anyone in your chain of authority, you know, like I have so many people who have helped me in the time past. Some 2 weeks ago, I was giving a talk somewhere, and I referred to when I wanted to get married, and I said, you know what, somebody sent me $200 from America, the last time I saw that person before, that was about 8 years before that time, and just sent an email to the person, and like, the person was in my chain of authority when I was growing, especially when I was going to Bible school. The man was helpful, you know, the man was working with Scripture University. It was helpful. So I sent a meeting and, you know, he responded, he replied. So people who are in your chain of authority, somebody who has helped you before. And I quickly balance this. If anybody has helped you before and now hurt you now, help you genuinely, and now the man or the woman now hurts you, please, it is not enough for you to fight the person. Let me repeat. If somebody has helped you before, genuinely, you want to pay school for your children, the person run around to sort it out for you, genuinely, and you know it. By error of omission or commission, it now be something that hurts you. Please, don't take it out on him. Just pray for, just ask for the mind of forgiveness and let go. You may not be close to him again. You may not move closer to her again, but don't take it out, because the truth of the matter, Yoruba says, "Any to shame to do money loaning, only shame to do nilola." That is the man who did something that is helpful, that was helpful to you yesterday, that you like, can mistakenly do anything that is wrong to you today. Do you understand? Not intentionally, anyway. You know, and you will know it will be so obvious that it was, you know, not intentional. All right. Anyone willing to correct you honestly. You made a mistake. I think I mentioned that earlier. You made a mistake or you run it on error. The person called you, talked to you genuinely, honestly. This is my opinion. Oh, you shouldn't have done that. You should have spoken to your boss like that. Or you should have maltreated your subordinate like that. You know, talk to you honestly. You see the integrity of their honesty through their speech and their words. You will see over the time.
Well, I discovered that this issue you're talking about, many people around do not like this aspect.
Yes. Which people now? People that you want to correct, or the people that
you want to correct?
You want to correct them.
Yes, you are. Yes. Especially this, our Indomie arrogant Range Rover generation. Yes, you are right. Our generation believes that anything they know is final. Our generation believe that anything they do is 100% is right. Yeah, they don't want to learn from people who have gone on the old path. They don't want to learn from people who have been there before. They tell you they know everything, especially because of internet. And unfortunately, we are importing other people's culture. We are importing foreign affairs into our local affairs. Mm-hmm. And I keep on saying, a George Bush in America can become a president. But a George Bush in Africa will die in bush if he doesn't play very well. So this attitude of importing things that will not work here, is we are just deceiving ourselves. You understand? I mean, if you go to Scotland, Wales, even UK, all these people, they have their culture, rich culture, and they protect it, they defend it. But here, don't you know what to do if your child plays English language? You beat him. Mm-hmm. But let him fail Igbo or Yoruba, you celebrate him. Meanwhile, there is no culture, there is no tradition, there is nothing that will be interpreted or manifested without the language. Without. Once you place that system on the wrong language, it will be misinterpreted. You won't get the value. All right. Anyone you can trust with your weakness, your pain, your finances.
That's a big one. I call it a big deal.
It's a big deal. I've seen couples that the husband does not know the pain
of his phone.
Phone case.
Or ATM.
In fact, the woman does not even know the banks the man is dealing with.
Well, the way the women say it, your money is our
money. Our money. My money is my money. You see? So, and that's a wrong signal to marriage issues in our nation. I'm telling you. So where is the statement that says the two shall become one? So where is the statement that says, so your car is my car, your house is my house? But when it comes to my own, I don't know, our Nigerian ladies, making that forgive us. Not everybody do, not everyone does that. But majority I've heard people say, no, your money is, how come? Even the husband does not know the banks is dealing with. Let alone know it. I mean, I can enter my wife's email. She can enter my email. I know the phone. She knows my phone and all that. You know. But many of us, we don't do that.
But this right now should just apply not to. I mean, as in people can trust in relationship. You could actually not everyone should trust
with your weakness. Yeah. With your weakness, it may not necessarily be your mentor. It may be someone who is even younger than you. Maybe somebody who is not even your mate, but you've tested the person and you see his integrity. Someone who you trust with your dream.
Okay.
You want to have a television station in the future, and you tell him your concept, your goal, everything. Not somebody that will just, as you are telling him, straight, he goes to NBC or NCC or whatever. To go and register and to go and expose the same thing, and he'll be making money. There is a business with Lagos State Government, I'm not going to mention, that I heard the story about the original person who brought it from Germany, just shared with one of the family members, and the person took it to the government, and today is making his millions through it. That's bad. That's terrible. Such a man can kill you. You know, and lastly, anyone who persuades you, anyone who drives you, anyone who propels you, anyone who pilots you, anyone who gives you a knock, hey, you can do it. Even when you are sleeping, this business, I'm not sure, Jerry. Oh, this career, this course, I'm not sure, I don't have money. No. You don't have money, you have two phones. Galaxy, whatever, and Galaxy this. Go and sell one. Use the money to do this. You know what I'm saying? You have two iPads. What are you doing? You have two television. You have two cars. Sell this. Use it. Someone who pushes you like that. You don't joke with such a person. Any questions, students?
I still have a question based on people you actually trying to correct. Honestly, what happens when you keep on trying to encourage them or to correct them and they don't listen? You still continue.
Do you know that I receive insults practically on daily basis? I'm not joking. I receive insults. Let me give you this example. Maybe my first book, when it came out, one of the bank MDs bought some for his staff. And I so much appreciate what he did. So what I did was, out of the 1,000 copies, the first one, I removed about 500 as complimentary copies. So one day I went to a particular area to go and share, to go and give people complimentary copies for free. And I saw this woman with two teenagers. And I'm like, hey, this book will be good for these people. So I walked up to her. Good afternoon, ma. Yes, what is it? Oh, no, nothing, ma'am. I just want to give you this book for your children. No. Ma, it is. No. Ma, I'm not. No, please. So immediately, as a life coach, I quickly browse through. What is happening? Is it that somebody just hurt her? Is it that he's expecting the particular money to hit her account? Did she fight with her husband this morning? I quickly gave her different reasons. Anyway. After I just walked out. So when I was going finally, I saw her, she wanted to. I said, ma, I'm sorry, I've not heard you the other. Please, don't talk to me. Please don't. And I went away. 3 weeks after, or a month after, this person called me that, somebody, a director in another bank, wants your book and can you please meet him so place? Justin. The exact place that this woman was sitting that day. Was the place this man sat? Are you here? I need 200 copies. And give me the check. Yeah. As I was turning back, I saw this woman coming in with the two children. And I heard the man, how are you sitting? Coming. Can you beat that imagination? Mm-hmm. The next thing, I greeted her. Yes, hi. And the children were, hi uncle, the book, dad, did you buy this book? Ah, so excited. They went, sit down, what's wrong with you? What happened? Have you? I said, yes, sir. Some time ago, some weeks ago, I met her, I wanted to give you, and the woman just told me that. And the man said, I mentioned her name again in the public. You know the meaning of that statement? It means the man knows the other very well. And the man said, what did you do? I said, I begged her. And he said, yes, he begged. And the man was like, what? And the man opened his wallet and counted $500. And for that attitude, thank you, God bless you. Now, listen to me. My temperament, I'm a pure choleric. On a good day, under normal condition, I won't take any nonsense. But because I know better and I understand human being anatomy, I calmed down. But look at what happened a month after. So if you are a leader, yes, you're a leader, you're a business person, patience is a virtue. God bless you.
And that's all we'll be taking on the program. We only thank you for staying with us, Mr. Zunda. We thank you.